Today we conclude the series with the message, Our Passion. So today we're talking about This Is Us, Our Passion. While values guide us, our passion drives us toward our purpose. And so today we're going to talk about that. I'd like you to turn with me to our text this morning. Please turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 34. John 4, verse 34. Jesus said, "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of Him who sent me and to finish His work." Well, God bless His word. Now, Jesus said, "My food." Now, of course, He was not referring to physical food. He was using a metaphor for His disciples to be able to better understand what He was talking about. He is saying that doing the will of God and to finish His work is like food in His body, all right? So we know that food in our body is our energy to be able to do things. Without food, and when we're starving, I mean, you get weak and you're not able to do anything. So food in our body gives us energy to do things. So He was talking about what sustains Him, what keeps Him going, is doing the will of the Father and to finish His work. That was His passion. And His purpose was to do the will of the Father and to finish His work. So therefore, His passion was to finish the purpose or to fulfill the purpose of God in His life. So what is passion then? Well, generally speaking, it is a strong feeling that causes you to do something. That is passion. Passion is the fuel that drives you to do something. Here's what others say about passion. Let me just get some quotes from other people. George Hegel said, "Nothing great in the world has ever been accomplished without passion." Now, Donald Trump, the president of the United States, said this, "Without passion, you don't have energy. Without energy, you have nothing." Now, Dave Ramsey, he said this, "Passion is so key in leading and creating excellence that I will hire passion over education and talent every time." What he's saying is, when someone has a passion, well, he'll educate himself, he'll do anything, right? So even if he didn't have all of those, when he has passion, he will be excellent in what he's doing. So basically, that's why he said he'd rather hire someone with passion than education or time. Now, T.D. Jakes said this, "If you can't figure out your purpose, figure out your passion, for your passion will lead you right into your purpose." So friends, passion is the driving force that causes us to do what we do. We are willing to make sacrifices for our passion, right? That's what we do. People who are passionate about things, are willing to make sacrifices. Jesus died, He sacrificed His own life because He was passionate about doing the will of the Father. I mean, that was His passion, and so He was willing to make that sacrifice even to His death. Now, people who are passionate do the same thing. There are people who are passionate about fishing or hunting will make sacrifices of their sleep, you know? To be there early in the morning. Like if you're passionate about fishing, you know, people will wake up so early in the morning, lose sleep, and then drive all the way to the north or wherever, to the lake, and wait patiently for the fish to bite. They could spend a whole day or whole morning and spend all of that because they're passionate about it. I don't have no problem with that. That's what they're passionate about. I'm just telling you what the sacrifice that they do. Now, if you're hunting, you know, they would go into the woods, wear all the stuff, put all the camouflage. They go through the extent of all the inconveniences, sit on a tree and wait for their prey. I mean, you know what I'm saying. And for a day waiting and sleep over and even miss going to the washroom, you know, just they might miss the deer. You know what I'm saying? So they will make all the sacrifice because they're passionate about that, okay? So I have nothing against that. I'm just letting you know what sacrifices people do about passion. People who are passionate about hockey will practice for hours on the cold ice, right? early morning just to make a practice. And here's another thing. When people were passionate about shopping, oh boy, they all of a sudden have strength. They could be tired, but then when they're passionate about shopping, all of a sudden they could not. They could walk around the mall. They never get tired, right? Because they're passionate about it. They'll even miss lunch and, you know, just wait for me over there. I'll go and go, go, go. They'll go through the crowds, even though it's busy. You know, they'll wait in line. You know, they'll do everything. Make sacrifices, even the parking lot, everything, because they're passionate about shopping. You understand? So this is what passion does. So basically, when we're talking about passion for God, right, that we're talking about the same kind of driving force, okay? So as a church, of course, we are passionate about the Lord. That is a given. We are passionate about the Lord and His righteousness, everything. That is the main reason why we exist. It is what keeps us serving. But what does it look like when, in a practical sense? When we are passionate about God, what does it look like in a practical way in the church? Well, there are many things that we are passionate about as a church. However, let me just share with you a few things today about, what we're passionate about as a church, okay? So the first one is this. We have a passion for making disciples, all right? This is us. We're passionate about that. We're passionate about making disciples and walking with them in their spiritual journey. All right. Now, Matthew 28, verse 19-20, Jesus said this, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Now, Jesus commanded the church to do that. And so this is His passion, and therefore it is also our passion. We are passionate about making disciples. This is us. Now, maybe other churches don't do this. Maybe that's not their passion, but we are passionate about making disciples. And the goal of discipleship is to raise sons and daughters that can accurately reflect the Father. Okay, that means that we need to mature them so that they will become more like Christ. That's the goal of discipleship, that we will grow and mature to become more like Jesus. Everything we do in the church is about making disciples. That's the reason why we divided the whole church to groups. You know, we've divided into community groups, you know, and that would be a smaller a group of community of people. And then in that community, we have smaller groups called the life groups. And, the life groups is where we belong to be discipled. That's where discipleship happens. And friends, the ministry is where we serve, all right? But the life group is where we are discipled. Are you hearing me? So ministry, we serve. The life group is where we are discipled. Making disciples involves more than just teaching people in a Bible study. That's the reason why we have to divide it in small groups, so that we would be able to walk with them. Because it's not just teaching a person about the Bible. It's much more than that. Of course, that's important, but it's more than that. Disciples are made. Amen? Say that with me. Disciples are made. That's why the Lord said, make disciples. They are made. They don't just happen. We need to walk with them. We need to love them, correct them, guide them, all of that. It's hard work. That's the reason why maybe some don't want to do that. It's easier to gather a crowd on Sunday or gather a crowd for the church than to make disciples. Friends, we cannot produce a disciple or make sons or daughters in the house. We cannot produce disciples just by preaching from the pulpit. Now, I can give you information, right? But that doesn't make you a disciple. You can come here every Sunday and receive information. that doesn't make you a disciple. Remember, as I told you before, you could be watching the food channel every day, and that doesn't make you a chef. The same thing. We don't become a disciple just by listening. Somebody has to walk with us. Jesus made disciples by spending time with them, not just Bible study. He corrected them, he taught them, he walked with them, he loved them, he cared for them. He did all of that. That was discipleship. And friends, that's what we're about. That's why you're going to see all of that. That's why they call you. That's why your leaders spend time with you. And so that's discipleship. We need to journey with you. The question that we need to ask ourselves is this: are we making disciples? Right? Who are you discipling? If I were to ask you and said, who are you discipling? Right? Now, think about that, because if you've been a Christian for 2 years, now, because maybe the first year you're just getting established, you just came to know the Lord, you're just even figuring out your own life. But if you've been a Christian for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, the question is, who have you discipled in that time? Not one person? You know, you don't have to disciple many. Jesus did not disciple many, but the question is, did you disciple at least one person? One person. You know, if you haven't discipled anybody in that period of time, that is not your passion. Would you agree? I mean, would that be fair to say? That is not your passion. You know, if you haven't discipled anybody aside from your wife or your husband or your children, I mean, if you haven't discipled anybody over that period of time, that is not your passion. And may I take it further? That means that you're not obeying God. And may I say it further? That means you don't love God. Because when you love God, you obey Him. To obey Him is to make disciples. So, there you go. That's the question. You know, I think about this. And I don't know, maybe you need to think about this too. I think about what would happen if one day you come face to face with the Lord. All of a sudden something happened. Now you're face to face with the Lord. Richard, you've been praying for God, take me to heaven. Now you're in heaven and the Lord says to you, what part of go make disciples did you not understand? Just what part of it? Oh, but Lord, you know, I was so busy. I was doing that. Yeah. Okay, I understand. But I told you I'll take care of that, right? I told you I'll take care of your finances. Yeah, I told you I'll care for that. But I'll provide your needs. But what part did you not understand about go make disciples? I mean, I think about that. And I say, God, I don't want to be accountable for that one day, right? And so that's why I need you to think about that. Because this is us. And so when we're doing that, that's the DNA that we have. When we're doing that, don't get offended, because that's what we're doing. We go make disciples. We're going to make disciple out of you when you come. We're gonna teach you, walk with you, right? Because it's also a two-way process. One way is we're making disciples, but it's a two-way process. We also must be willing to be disciple. The question is, are you willing to be disciple? Luke chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus said, whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. So if we're not willing to follow him, if we're not willing to make the sacrifices, right, then you can't be my disciple. We must allow God, through the leaders, through the people that he placed over us, to form our life, to mold us, to change us. Because if we are by ourselves, and you know, how in the world God is going to change us? He uses people around us, he places people over our life. God the Father put Joseph and Mary over Jesus. You know, even though he's a perfect God, he still had to walk with them and obey them over the years. And he matured in stature. In the same way with us, we need to have people over us that will help us to mature and to grow. So, but we must be willing to be discipled. We need to be demonstrating it. We cannot mature and grow in our character to become a disciple just by attending and listening. We need people to walk with us. Amen? We need to be demonstrating what it means to be a disciple. Here's my observation. A true disciple will disciple others. That's my observation over the year. People who are not discipled will not disciple others. Right? So if we're not discipled, maybe because of our own reasons that we don't want people to speak into our life, we're not willing, we don't have time, we're not available. If we're not doing that, you'll find usually they don't have any disciple because they don't have anybody walking with them. So that's one. We have a passion making disciples. The second passion that we have, that we're passionate about, is a passion for ministry. Being a disciple involves doing ministry. Amen? Discipleship is about the being, while ministry is about our doing. So we are passionate about both, being and doing. You know, we wanna grow in our character, but we wanna use that for God's glory. So we're passionate about both doing and being. Now, this is us. While other churches may only emphasize about ministry, that you just come and serve, it doesn't matter what your attitude is, maybe you can just do that. Maybe others just emphasize doing ministry, but we emphasize on both. This is us. We believe that, you know, we need to grow in our character. We need to be discipled, but we also need to serve in ministry, right? People sometimes want to serve, like sing or play music or whatever, but they don't want to change their attitude. They don't want to change their character, you know? They just want to serve. I just want to play, or I just want to sing, or I just want to usher, but you know, don't disciple me. I don't need to belong to a life group. I don't need to grow in my character. So some people, they just want to serve. So your being, friends, your being is your character. Your ministry is your serving with your gift. So, you know, we need to serve with our gift. As we grow in our walk with God, we discover who we are in God. We discover the gifting that God has given us. And we obey Him in our life, and then we begin to serve the people of God with the gift that He has given us. All right, so in doing that, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 12 says this, "And He Himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ." So, in other words, the Bible tells us that the reason Christ gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to the church was for the equipping of the saints. Or the saints is the people of God. So it's for equipping us, that's the people of God, for the work of the ministry. So there is a work. And that is in the ministry. So we need to be equipped, all right? We need to grow, we need to mature, but we need to do the work of the ministry. And the work of the ministry, that word ministry, in the original Greek word, is the word diakonia. Diakonia is where we get the word deacon. You know, when deacons serve, it actually means, the word means ministry or service. So when we have deacons, basically that's about, you know, doing the work of the ministry, the service. So that's what it means, that when we as pastors equip you, it's for you to be able to serve in the ministry. So Paul is saying that the role of the fivefold office, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, is to prepare the people, all right, of God for the work of the ministry or service. Therefore, ministry is serving the people of God. That's ministry. So the question is, do you have a ministry? Are you serving the people of God? Now, we need to understand that when we grow in our walk with the Lord, we need to be used by the Lord to serve in the ministry, in whatever capacity. You know that there are so many ministries that you can serve in. You know, this is us in our church. We encourage you to serve in a ministry. If we don't have that ministry, we'll create one. Whatever it is, just as long as you could serve. Now here's what it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 11. It said this, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. So we should not lack in zeal. In other words, we should be passionate. Say passionate. We should be passionate in serving the Lord by serving His people. Now some would say, well, I just want to serve the Lord. I just don't like the people. I mean, you can't serve God without serving people. So you can't say, I love the Lord, but you hate your brother. You know, we need to learn that serving the Lord is serving His people. So when we want to serve God, I say, oh, I want to be a servant. I want to serve the Lord. We'll serve His people. In what way? Well, that's why the church creates ways for you to serve, because we don't want you to be disobedient before God. We want to make a way for you, give you opportunities. We announce it. We make all kinds of ministry thing. We have a ministry launch. We feature areas where you can serve and encourage you to get involved. Now, we've done our part because that is what God wants us to do. Now, we make sure we give you those opportunities. Do we have youth ministry? We have children's ministry, worship ministry. We have media. We have family life. We have finance. We have art. I mean, all kinds of ministry. There are some that are networks like men's network or women's. They're just more of a fellowship that they come together. The others are really ministries because they serve people in those areas. And we have those ministries, ushering ministry, guest services ministry. These are really serving people. Now, the question is, are you serving in any? So, you know, if we're featuring all of this, but you're not doing it, then it's no longer our fault. Because this is us. We're passionate about ministry. This is our DNA. You see people serving. Now, I'll tell you something. That's why I'm happy about our church. I think we have more than 80%, almost 90% are serving. Are you hearing me? Come on, give glory to God. In some capacity, you know, we're about 90, almost 90%, if I were to get the exact number, but we have about 90% serving the Lord in whatever capacity. Maybe they're in the guest services as an usher, or they're maybe in the technician, or they're in the children's helping. They're doing something. Or maybe they're behind the scenes. Some of them, you don't see them, but they're working so hard, doing the internet, you know, doing graphics, doing all kinds of the things that you see on the flyers there. People made that over and above their time at work. They're at home doing something or whatever. So there's people serving on all those capacities. So the question you should ask yourself is, do you have a ministry? You know, whatever that is, make sure you serve. Make sure you do that. You need to be passionate about serving God, by serving the Lord, by serving in a ministry. Now, you need to express that gift that God has given you by serving people. This is what we're about here. Now, you know, you don't just use it to work and get an income. Imagine how you would face the Lord one day, that He would say, I gifted you all that for the advancement of the kingdom, and all you did was make a living. Think about that. I died for the church. I died for people to receive Him and to do all that. I mean, I did, and I provided all your needs, and all you did was make a living. But think about that. So, friends, we have this year, make sure, this is us, make sure you find a ministry, just even a short ministry, whatever. If you don't have that much time, you can serve in something, all right? Even if you just had to smile, that is serving people coming, hi, but it's serving, okay? So make sure that you do that, all right? So, when you're serving in the ministry, you still need to belong to a life group, all right? Because that is where you're being discipled. In the ministry is where you serve with your gift. in the life group is where you are discipled. So we're making disciples, we're serving in ministry, right? Others, they just try to disciple them in the ministry. You know, some ministry leaders just discipling the people, and the people there in that ministry are not involved in anywhere. They're not belonging to a life group. Now, you know, that's very difficult. Because what if the person is involved in several ministries? Then who's really discipling them? Because if you're the one discipling in that ministry, then another person in another ministry discipling that person, then it becomes very difficult. That's the reason why we want to make sure people understand that this is us in our church, that we are passionate about making disciples through your life group where you're discipled, and then you serve in a ministry. Amen? And you know what? The best thing that the ministry leader could have when they are serving, when you're serving there, is you have a good attitude because you're being discipled. Right? Because your ministry leader doesn't need to disciple you. They just want to give you the task. They want to give you what you need to do, how you serve people. They'll train you. But they're not there to disciple you all over again. So make sure that you're being discipled in your life group. Okay? So, you need a spiritual parent. The question you should ask yourself is, do I have a spiritual parent? Okay? That's why we make sure you belong in a life group. The third passion that we have is the passion for mission. Right? So we're passionate about mission. Well, ministry is serving people of God in the house of the Lord. Mission is reaching out to those who do not know the Lord. Amen? So in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus said, go and make disciples. In the Gospel of Mark, he says, go and preach the gospel. So here's what he said in Mark 16, verse 15 to 18. He said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well. So Jesus commands his disciples to go into all the world and share the gospel to all creation or to every person. Friends, that is the mission. Right? As a church, we're passionate about missions. Since the beginning of Champion Life, we have been actively involved in reaching people for Christ in communities and around the world. Churches are birthed in the communities because the gospel has been preached there. You know, we preach the gospel here in Brampton. That's why a church was planted here. We began to preach the gospel in the community in Toronto. That's why it birthed there. And then in Scarborough and now in Durham, we started there. And in London, wherever the word of God is preached and people come to know the Lord, then we plant the church. So that's the mission. That's why we continue to give birth to churches, because we wanted to preach the gospel to every community, to every person. So we spend a good percentage of our resources to do mission. You look at how much we spend on mission. We feed the hungry and help the children in Africa. We've been doing that for 16 years. We built schools in Ghana and continue to support those children. And we do missions there. We do a mission in Trinidad. We just recently helped the children there. We sent a team to help the children and minister to them and also help them with their backpacks and feed them. In the Philippines, we do that all the time. We've done mission in Japan, Hong Kong, Macau, UK, Italy. I mean, there's a lot of others that I can't remember. We also respond to calamities, like the time of the typhoon, Yolanda. If you remember, that really hit the Philippines at that time. I was even down there, and we spent the money in supporting families that didn't have houses anymore. We even built some houses there. So there was a lot of things we did. Now, the Taal volcano. You know, in the Philippines, there's an eruption of the volcano in the Philippines. And many are affected. we now have a church in the Philippines who can immediately respond. That's part of why we established the church there. So now that church was able to respond, went to the evacuation center, gave food and water and all of those things to help, even masks to help the people in the Philippines right now. So this year we'll be going again in mission in August. So in all of our missions, we preach the gospel. Amen? And that is why we encourage all of you to be involved in mission in whatever capacity. Now, thank you for giving to missions, you know, being supporting the mission. Whenever we do that, you know, because this is our DNA, this is us, this is what we are passionate about. Thank you for giving for the mission. But at the same time, when you have the opportunity, you need to go. But you say, well, Pastor, I can't go into all the world. I can't go there. Well, let me tell you something. Your world starts in your house. It starts in your neighborhood. It starts in your workplace, your city. So wherever there are people who do not know the Lord and not heard the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is your world. So wherever that is, you need to go. And we don't have a reason why we cannot share to them, because that is our passion, to go and preach the gospel. Right? So we need to do that. That means sharing the gospel to everyone you know. In your school, sharing to the other student. In your workplace, sharing it to your office mate. In your neighborhood, sharing it to your neighbors. I mean, in the marketplace, sharing it to the person who is serving you, helping you in the shopping mall or wherever. We need to have the passion to share the gospel and do the mission. Amen? So that's why, because of our passion, we will be doing a go and share campaign for the next 2 months. And what we will be doing is to encourage you to be involved and equip you on sharing the gospel wherever you are. And that's a great thing that we're going to be doing in the next little while. Amen? Now, so this is us. Our passion is for making disciples, passion to serve in a ministry, and our passion is to go in mission. Everything that we do revolves around those three things in the church. We make disciples, we do ministry, and we do mission. That is the most important thing. Now, of course, other churches may be doing something else, but this is us. This is who we are. This is what we're about. This is our passion. And as we conclude this series, I trust that you've had a glimpse of who we are as a church. We don't have everything in place yet. We're still in a journey, right? We're still, you know, rising up and learning some more things. But we're in a journey to be the bride that the Lord is coming back for. This is us, our family, our values, and our passion. I hope that you will choose to belong to this church. And if you belong to this church, I pray that you will align yourself to our family, our values, and our passion.